Hello, this is Senator Roxanne J. Persaud, representing the 19th Senatorial District, coming to you from Albany. Usually we have a legislative report, but today we're going to have a conversation between myself and our Chief of Staff, who's new to the district. Her name is Veronica Avis. So Veronica, welcome to Senate District 19 officially, and welcome to Albany.
Thanks.
So, just give us some background on you.
Sure. Before working in Senate District 19, I had been the political director for Planned Parenthood of New York City. So I worked both on legislative priorities for healthcare in New York and on elections and campaign organizing and working with volunteers. And before that, I had been a representative staff in the congressional office, New York 9 at the time, New York 11, for Representative Yvette Clark working in Brooklyn.
So how do you like working in the government's office?
I wouldn't know what else to do with myself. If you can see things that need to be changed and there's a place where you can start to make those incremental changes, then that's what I'm passionate about.
That's good. Tell us, how did you get involved in politics? Just getting involved in community and just relationship building across communities.
Sure. It's actually a little bit of a funny story. I was newer to Brooklyn. I had only lived in Brooklyn a little bit less than a year. I was a student at the time. And I grew up in New York, but not in Brooklyn per se. And my congress member took a vote that I didn't like and I didn't agree with. So I called the office to find out why she did, especially as a freshman congress member, what her reasoning was for that decision. And I ended up talking for a long time with one of the people in the office about why the legislation wasn't progressive enough. And I was really impressed with a freshman Democrat who would break with the rank and file membership and leadership to take a moral stand, even if I, you know, still disagreed with the reason, the actions, if not the reasons. Mm-hmm. So I offered to come in and volunteer, and I started volunteering while I was a student. And I had been in the office for, I think, just about a month as a volunteer, and we had a new chief of staff coming on, and it was right before ACA happened, and he needed someone in the district office who'd be able to understand what was going on in DC with the legislation and to be able to talk in the community and to constituents and at public meetings about what that need was and to translate what I was hearing in the district back to DC. And so I was just about to finish school, and they asked me to stay. So I sort of fell into politics by writing an angry letter to my congress member.
See that? People out there, that's what it takes, community involvement. You see something that you don't agree with, contact us. So now that you're in Senate District 19, you know, give us some insight. What have you learned so far about the district?
Sure. I think one of the interesting and terrible things of being in this side of New York government is you can see the process by which we draw district lines for Senate, for Congress, for City Council. And so what we have in Senate District 19 is a district where we see some communities that are sort of fractured by the district lines and other communities that are able to be made whole by the way that the lines are drawn. So in District 19, there are different communities that have very specific needs. And one of the things that I've been trying to do is work with the staff who are already representing those communities in the office to see exactly what those needs are respective to the communities and make sure we're responsive to everyone in the district, not just say first-generation folks in Canarsie who are having those issues that come with navigating new citizenship versus folks in East New York who have different problems. In Brownsville, we had a big issue with high school potentially closing and the impact that would have on education and young people and safe spaces in the neighborhood. And then we'll be on the south end of the district, close to the water, and a lot of folks have very serious environmental impact issues, flooding and housing, and making sure that the issues that are the loudest in the community aren't the only issues that are being given space, because all across the district that there are still folks who need help with housing, with health care, and those are universal concerns, and making sure that those things aren't lost in the noise of
the bigger picture. Mm-hmm. Right. And that's important, because we have, as you know, I have a policy that, you know, we take care of all of the needs in the district to the best of our ability. We never tell anyone that we cannot do something or we will not do something. We always say we will try to get something done. And so we were doing that to the best of our ability. And so you're coming on and making sure that the staff is doing that. It sends a message across the district that we are really committed to our district.
And I think that's important what you just said there, because people come to their elected official's office generally in two circumstances. They're at their wit's end because they haven't been able to get help through any other venues, and they don't necessarily know if we're the right place to get those services, but they don't know where else to go. And a lot of folks who know you or who've seen you in the community or have worked with you will come to us because they have a problem. And it's my job as chief of staff to make sure that the person who's sitting down with them and managing that case finds out exactly what that intersection of what we are able to help with, or whether if we're not a venue who can provide that help, some other either organization or if it's a city or a federal issue, that they're directly connected with someone who can follow up. And if there's circumstances where there truly is nothing to do, if it's a legal issue and we can't intervene because there's ongoing legal actions or something in those circumstances, that we've sat down with them and made them understand what our capacity is, what the limits of that are, and that they know that they could come back and be served if there was another issue that was impacting their lives, but there are parameters beyond which we're able to help them with. And it's that understanding, even if we aren't able to actually change the issue that they've come to see us, but they know that we're open to helping. But the reason why we're not taking any further action, or the reason why we're asking them
that
to go to another
office. Yes.
Because then they understand that we're not, it's not just an exasperated, you've come to the wrong place, but it's, thank you for coming in. I take this issue very seriously. Unfortunately, we aren't the right place to serve this particular need, but we'd love to set you up with an appointment at X. And then folks understand that we value them and what's going on in their lives, but that we want to connect them to the place where they can receive support.
So this, you know, you're here now approximately 4 months, 3 months?
Yeah, this is my second month, yeah.
Oh, wow. See, I'm thinking it's longer. And you've just done your first event in the district.
Mm-hmm.
So give us some feedback on that. What do you thought of the event? And, you know, as you know, we have multiple events planned throughout the year.
Mm-hmm.
And so give us some feedback. What do you think about that?
Sure. I think it's funny. The thing that I'm getting used to the most, I think, is the process by which, because I know how the federal government worked in a lot of ways from having worked there. And I've been doing not-for-profit work in New York City for 7 years or so. So learning the exact process by which a state office does those rules and the parameters around them.
Understanding that there's no money.
Exactly. I've never been in the position to throw events without a budget before, so that was interesting. And making sure that we have what we need to support the community. For example, this was an Easter egg hunt, so we needed Easter eggs and candy for young people to make sure that we're soliciting them from community organizations so that it's not just about getting what we need for the event, mm-hmm. but that we're involving businesses in the community in a community event, right? We put the work in to make the event happen, but it's not the Senator Persaud Easter egg hunt. It's the Senate District 19 Easter egg hunt,
correct.
Right? It's to serve the community, and businesses in the neighborhood are part of the community as well. So making sure that as we're doing that process, we're involving folks who live in the community. So they're, folks are seeing the businesses that they support, supporting things and events for young people. For example, this was targeted for young people. It's an important line to toe, but it shouldn't be overlooked that it's about the community.
It's about community. It's always about community and forming those alliances and, you know, the collaborations, mm-hmm. which is important because we can't do it on our own.
Right.
And for us to have anything successful in the district, we must collaborate and let the community know this is for you.
Right, and businesses mm-hmm. should know that too, is that folks who are coming out to these events, people want to support the places that support them.
That's correct. That's correct. So our next event, I think we have a number of things planned. It's Easter. You know, after Easter, then what?
Then we have a college and student resource fair. That's going to be April 14th at South Shore High School, and it's important for for young people who are thinking about higher education, but also for families thinking about camp and summer youth employment and FAFSA and all the things that go into preparing young people for education. And we also have, on April 7th, we're going to be giving out rain barrels. And like we were talking about before, you know, the southern end of the district, there's a lot of ecological conservation issues and worries about flooding, but there are homeowners all over the district, in Brownsville, in East New York, in Flatlands, in Canarsie. And so we want to make sure that for folks who are mindful of that, there's a lot of water to catch in New York City, and there's not a lot of grass to absorb all that runoff. And so,
and it's also in part in collaboration, you know, with our Earth Month celebrations, you know, the how do we preserve our earth, right?
Exactly, and we want to make sure that it's both, it's good for homeowners and it's good for the environment. So it's really a win-win for folks in the community.
Homeowners, you know, you're saved because you're not going to be using your regular tap water to water the garden or to wash the car or to wash the yard. You know, you're going to be saving on your water bill. And we know, living in New York City, our bills are high.
Exactly. So it saves money on water, and then we're not using potable water.
Exactly.
That could be used for drinking or cooking, or right? There's... water is not an issue in New York, but it's an issue in the world.
That's right. And we have to, you know, the world looks at us to see what we're doing.
Right.
And if we're showing the world that, yes, we're invested in the Earth's issues, they'll follow us also.
Right. And we've seen what it looks like across the world. And there's going to be time maybe when we need to send some of our water to other places because there's not enough.
So what else after, you know, so come April, what else after that? We have a lot of things planned for the year.
Yeah.
So you're in Albany today.
Yes.
You know, you're getting your feet wet, so to speak, in Albany. So give us a sense of, you know, why do you think it's important that you connect with the Albany office also?
Sure. I think being in the district office and being the chief of staff, which means that I really have to know everything that's going on in Albany and everything that's going on in the district. The district office, it's important that beyond just serving the constituents who walk through the door, we have folks who know what's going on in the community. And we translate those community concerns into what you bring before your colleagues in Albany, and making sure that the staff in Albany know what those concerns are, so that way they can help support the legislative work that you're doing and the conversations that you're having with your colleagues. And on the other side of that, making sure folks in the district know what's going on in Albany. You know, that's what people understand of government, right? We're in the budget conversations right now, and people who understand how state government works know that we're in the budget conversations, and they want to have those conversations in the district. Is X in the budget? Is Y in the budget? What does the senator support? So staff need to be nimble with those conversations and understand what's going on, and also relaying those concerns back to Albany, so that way the work that you're doing here is reflective not just of what's going on in Albany, but what the needs in the community are, right? That's why representation is important in government. If government were just a bunch of white guys, right, we would have one set of perspectives, right? Mm-hmm. And making sure that we're sending folks who represent our communities to Albany to have that process, it means you have a different lived experience than I have. I have a different lived experience than my assembly member has, right? And making sure that we have folks all across the district who are honoring what's going on in communities and getting that back to me so I can get it back to you, so that way the work that we're doing in Albany is truly reflective of what the needs
of the district.
Yeah.
Yep. And we do have a diverse district. You know, today, later today, there's going to be a group of Bengali constituents who are going to be here. And so we have, and they're going to be talking about their needs. Their needs are different and mostly from the needs of someone, say, in Bergen Beach, or someone in Brownsville, or someone in Sheepshead Bay. So we have to always be mindful of the needs of our community collectively.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, Veronica, thank you for coming to Albany. Thank you for being here on the legislative report that has been changed today to just a conversation about Senate District 19 and the role that you're playing. So as we're closing out, just give us some feedback as to what do you expect?
What do I expect? That's
what
great.
What do you expect?
I expect staff that are knowledgeable and care and hardworking for the community, and that we reflect what you want the district to look, what you want our office to look like, that we're honoring your vision for the office and for the district.
And most importantly, everyone, we want our constituents in Senate District 19 to be happy with what the work that we're doing. We want them to say, my senator, the senator's staff are the best there is. They are willing to always help you. So thank you for joining us today. I'm Senator Roxanne J. Persaud, representing the fabulous Senate District 19. Thanks again.